Hi, Laurie.
Hello. Nice theme song that we just heard. That was beautiful. Thanks. Yeah.
So we're going to talk about the Arctic and the real Arctic and the Arctic of the imagination. And we're going to see where it takes us. I think we were going to get a picture up on the screen. A picture from Mercator's map of the Arctic Circle. But it isn't here. Oh, there it is. So this is a very early imagined map of the Arctic. And in the middle, you have the magnetic circle and four rivers flowing in the cardinal directions, feeding the world.
Very convenient.
Very convenient. Yes. So this is the 1595.
Mm-hmm. I wonder before that, is this the first map of the top of the world, do you think?
I'm not sure, but if it exists, they probably have it here at the Royal Library, because that is where this map is coming from. Yeah. I know that the Greek didn't dare above certain latitudes, because they just imagined that it would be endless ice anyway, so why would they go there?
Yeah.
But the Romans, they had roads, so they went.
Right. Everything was flat. Every road back to Rome,
Yes.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So this idea of the north, of the Arctic, the frozen, distant lands, was it a part of your childhood, your...
It was a big part, world. Along with snow, along with things that we didn't know, along with... polar bears and Canada, actually, just start with Canada was already mysterious for us. And I grew up in Chicago, and in a very, very cold, was, I remember being so filled with snow and cold, and the winters were very long and dark and very icy and very deep snow. And I remember always wanting to go to Canada because that was where the map ended in a way, and it also was kind of going back in time to go to Canada because they were always about 15 years. You'd see the clothes from 15 years ago. You'd see the TVs from 15 years ago. So it was really like going back and going north was going back in time. So it was very romantic for us. It was really. And I also, as a child, was a kind of sky worshiper. I liked the sky was so mysterious to me. Again, I come from a super flat land in Illinois, so there was just 180 degrees of sky, and so I was mesmerized by what was going on there. So, yeah, I had a big love affair with the North. And you? As a kid?
You know, I'm from Iceland, so we are already up there in the north.
Yeah.
But somehow the north was still, you know, farther up there than in Iceland. Yeah. For us, the north was Greenland and up northwards. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had the dark nights, we had the snow and the ice, and we have our glaciers. But somehow we felt that because we were a modern society, that we did not belong to the far north. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we had the awareness of how close it was in time, mm-hmm. how close the old days of drift ice and mm-hmm. polar bears coming ashore, you know, how close they were. Mm-hmm. But that was more or less over when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. One or two polar bears walked ashore and made the news, and they were killed, and modern life continued.
Yeah.
But you had a special relationship with ice, didn't you?
With ice?
Yes. You were a figure skater?
Oh yeah. Well, I lived. We lived next to a lake, and also I used ice in some music that I did early as a kind of clock. Actually, it was I was inventing a violin that played by itself, and had a speaker inside, and you could play violins, play live a duet with it, and so you're in this kind of situation of a loop, and you don't know. It doesn't have an end, this music. So it's just looping away, and you think, oh, how is it going to end? You don't know how it's going to end. So I wore some ice skates with their blades frozen into blocks of ice, and then played until the ice melted and the concert was over. That was just the way it was done.
Mm.
And then I had one thing. I played these in Italy a lot, outside in just like a, unannounced in piazzas, and there was a guy who came to the shows, and I don't know how he found them. He just showed up, and I would dedicate these concerts to talk to the group who is around I'm playing, and I would say, I'm dedicating these concerts to my grandmother, because on the day she died, I walked out on a frozen lake, and I saw a lot of ducks, and they were flapping their wings, and they didn't move. They didn't go away. And I got very close to them, and they still didn't move. And I saw that their feet had been frozen in the new layer of ice, and they couldn't move. And so I had made this dedication in basic Italian to the group who is there, not very good Italian. And this man who is becoming the kind of impresario is explaining to newcomers in the group, she's playing these songs because once she and her grandmother were frozen together in a lake. Thank you for that explanation.
Yes.
but I did always have a fixation on the pole as well, and once hitchhiked there, at least tried to.
And how did that go?
It didn't go well.
No?
No.
How far north did you?
You know,
did you manage to go?
I was going to read the story, but I would just rather talk with you, because it seems kind of weird to go, no, I'm going to tell you a story. So the story, I'll really tell you the gist of it, which I decided, because it was super hot summer in New York in 1974, I thought, you know, I bet it's really nice and icy at the North Pole. And you know how in a cartoon you hang a little note on your doorknob that says, gone to the North Pole. So I thought, I'd just go there. So I got, you know, maybe 70 pounds of bannock, this kind of high protein paste that explorers used, and a hatchet, and a tent, and I spent 3 months. I hitchhiked. I went out onto Houston Street in New York, and I just went, you know, going north, you know, and I went with mostly guys who were, they were like, I was hitchhiking eventually in small planes that had just one letter to deliver to like Attawapiskat or some little settlement, an indigenous settlement or Eskimo place. Well, no, they're, and so it took a long time, and it eventually I turned back because of my hatchet. I was chopping some wood. I was still below the timber line, so I hadn't gotten so far. I did what you should never do when you are chopping wood. I looked up, you know, the hatchet fell out of my hand like this, and I looked up to see where it had gone. You know, it came out like this, and I thought, oh my, I could be walking around with a hatchet embedded in my head, and nobody knows where I am. So this was the trip, and then it took 3 months to do, and I was also, I'd only seen pictures of the Northern Lights. I hadn't really seen them for myself, and then they were unveiled. There was just giant layers and layers and layers of veils of colors, and I thought, for a while, there's been a thermonuclear war, and I'm the only one left in all of North America. And what will I do then? You know, it was getting a little crazy. I could see how explorers would really start, you know, going off the rails.
Yeah, the Northern Lights are amazing.
How are they in Iceland? Do you see them clearly in Iceland?
Yes, we see them quite clearly.
Yeah.
And they never lose their wonder.
Yeah.
you know, people think that if you live there, that you get used to them. But they are always, always, always wonderful. They're always something that you know, you call your kids and say, come out, you know, because the Northern Lights are there.
Yeah.
And there's such a mystery to them because they're so silent and they're so big. You sense how big they are. Yeah. They're so far away. And yes, they're just one of the most amazing spectacles. And So I don't think they will make you crazy unless you're seeing them for the first time and you don't know what is going on.
Yeah, okay.
And you maybe have images of like the nuclear tests they were doing in the air. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think the nuclear tests they did like, you know, what would you say, in the air,
mm-hmm.
yeah, in the 60s.
Yeah.
They are the thing, they are the man-made thing that comes closest to the Northern Lights, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's true.
But not in beauty, but maybe in wonder and awe. Yes.
What was the last thing you said?
In awe.
Oh, in awe.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
you, in Neo-Arctic, the piece you did, you had something called optics, and I think you weren't going to show it, but did that have something to do with the Northern Lights or not?
Yes, you're right. We're going to see a clip
okay.
from Neo-Arctic, which is an oratorio that was premiered here in Copenhagen just around a year ago. Mm-hmm. And the fragment we're going to see is from a song for optics, or song for the optics. But in this case, it is the optical world of the Arctic when it is on its own, when things are reflecting in each other, mm-hmm. when a drop of water, bends a whole glacier within itself,
mm-hmm.
and a pool reflects a jumping hare. So it is the world of the Arctic without man, mm-hmm. and without God.
Yeah.
I think we will see a short part of this. This is a production by Hotel Proforma, directed by Kirsten Delholm, and I was very proud to be asked to be a part of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Should we see it?
beautiful.
It's very beautiful. Yes.
So nice. Yes. Wow. And why are they wearing the glasses?
So
where those were.
The Neo-Arctic is about the changing Arctic, and the possibility of survival in the times of climate change. And with the change in light and radiation and everything,
oh, I see. Yeah.
The glasses are needed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's also exciting to see like performers seeing things that the audience can't see. It's almost like they have a show that they're seeing that's invisible to the audience.
Yes,
which is a nice idea too. But I was just thinking of last week of going to, or a couple of weeks ago, and I went to see the total eclipse right in the path of totality. And I went down south in the United States to be in the path in the Blue Ridge Mountains. And it was, I have seen some partial eclipses, but total eclipse, to see that perfection of the sun and moon and just looking the same size. Everyone there, we were all around a little lake, and everyone began crying. It was really so incredibly beautiful to see the corona. It was really, really exciting. I hadn't been prepared to see something that was so frightening and beautiful at the same time. I know once I woke up and I wasn't also ready for this. It was we were waking up and the sun was rising and the moon was setting, and they were next to each other, exactly next to each other, and at the same luminance. And I literally screamed, because there's something that we have in the back of our necks as people, you know, that when you just kind of go, I'm on another planet, you know, because it didn't make any sense at all. I'd never seen that, and I wasn't prepared for it. So when you see something like that, it has this otherworldliness that this work feels like it has this kind of awestruck, you know, feeling of looking at nature. That's just
And it's very interesting that as human beings we've learned how to appreciate nature, to be impacted by nature as aesthetic, as an aesthetic thing. And of course it is something that derives from our ability for abstract thought, that we are looking for symbols and we're reflecting ourselves in nature.
That's a complicated thing, that's what we're looking for in terms of, and then saying that's beautiful or whatever, because I just remember I had a very, very strange gig once, being the artist in residence at NASA. And that was not a job I'd been looking for. I just got a call one day, and I was having a very bad day in the studio, and someone said, "Hello, we're from NASA, and we'd like you to be the first artist in residence." And I said, "You're not from NASA." You know, just when you get your dream call, you can't believe it. So anyway, they said, "Yes, Donna, they called back. We're from NASA. We'd like you to do this." And finally I said, "Well, what does an artist in residence do in a space program? And where do you go? You know, but where do you reside?" You know, and they said, you know, they didn't know the answer to that. And what did I think the answer was? I said, "Who are you people?" Now, I took the job. It was 3 years of just being a fly on the wall, because they're doing art at NASA. You know, they're making a stairway to space. You know, it's a big kind of rig in the middle of the Pacific. So the biggest problem with space travel, of course, is the blast off and all the energy that you need to, you know, send something that big up. So they thought, let's just haul it up the stairs instead of the big fire. So they, you know, the idea is to gradually bring the rocket up to this top of the stairs, and then you just drive off when you're above gravity, really easy. So anyway, they were doing stuff like that. And but the reason I was bringing this up was that nobody would talk to me at NASA. I'm wearing my badge, artist in residence, NASA. Cartoon rocket, you know, and I was like, you know, ah, what are you doing? What are you doing? And it was really pretty annoying, I'm sure. And the people who really had time to talk were the nanotechnologists, because they were more theoretical. They liked to talk about why we're doing things, what it is. Not, I mean, the robotics guys and all engineers were so fascinating, but the theoreticians were these guys. And they would often cite Einstein, and they would say that Einstein rejected some of his most well-known theories. Why? Because they weren't beautiful. And I thought, what does that mean? You know, and I started thinking, okay, well, one of the Western ideas of something that's beautiful is symmetry. The one thing is, has this kind of balance. And then I thought, you take this idea, for example, to Japan, and it's often considered kind of idiotic. Why is it good that one thing looks like another? Why does that make it better? What is it about that? The rhyming thing, moon and June, and just this and left and right, and why? Because we have a bicameral brain and 2 feet and arms, and we just like to look like us. They have, and their whole aesthetic structure is different. I mean, a poem, haiku, doesn't really necessarily compare this to that, and work on this whole system of comparison. It would just go, you know, early morning thaw, the puppeteer waves. That's the poem. You're like, make of it what you will. It just, you know, it doesn't say the puppeteer is like love, the puppeteer is like loss. No, it's just a puppeteer who's waving at you. End of story. So, you know, it's I learned a lot by about trying to think of what beauty was, and also, you know, how it related to technology and so-called and science as well, working there.
Yes, we have a tradition of thinking technology versus nature. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we can think nature and technology, science versus art, art with science. The first album I heard with your music was Big Science.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So could you talk a little bit about your relationship, you know, the relationship between art and science as you see it?
Maybe not so much versus technology versus art or nature. It was how they get intertwined and get interpreted by each other and have a different relationship. For example, if you, let's say, go back to that rhyming nature, what are the other ways that things like that can relate catalytically, for example? So how does technology and nature relate by changing each other, you know, and by influencing each other? So, and also there's some often this feeling of that technology is a way to rescue nature and rescue us. And the song that I wrote for that record, one of the main songs in that was Oh Superman, which was about, I wrote this song, it's a song about the failure of technology, really. And it was written when we were going to go rescue some hostages in the desert, and the idea was we were going to send in these big helicopters, and they were going to rush down and rescue the hostages and lift off, and the war would be, you know. And what happened was the helicopters crashed in the desert and burned, and the hostages were killed, and everyone was like, technology will not always, if ever, really save you. So the song is a long song. We could look at the beginning of it, because I have a clip of this. It's from the 80s, so it looks kind of like it's from the 30s, you know. It's a long time ago. But it was based on a Massenet song, Au Souverain, and it's a prayer. So the Massenet song is Au Souverain, au juge, au père, au Lord, au Father, or judge. It is an appeal to to rationality and to faith and to family, really, in a way. So we'll look at the first part of that, and then I'll just summarize the last part, because it's a very long song. Shall we look at that? That's called Oh Superman, coming up on... there it is. I'm not someone who sings old songs very often or even looks at them, but I did sing this song. I was right after 9/11. It was a very eerie feeling to sing Here Come the Planes, their American planes, smoking or non-smoking. And people are going, what, did you just write that just now? And I said, you know, you forget that we're in the same war that we were when I wrote this song. You know, it's the same. It gets new labels. It gets called a war against terror. It gets, well, you know, a war. You know, so it just gets new sort of branding. But it is the exact same war in pretty much the exact same part of the world. So, the song ends with a series of invocations that go, and then it kind of splits it down to the end of 'cause when love is gone, there's always justice. And when justice is gone, there's always force. And when force is gone, there's always mom. Hi, mom. And so anyway, the last lines are, so hold me, mom, in your long arms. Hold me, mom, in your long arms, in your electronic arms, in your petrochemical arms, in your arms. And so it's a way to, kind of combine your idea of where you are with your family and your motherland or fatherland. And a couple of years ago, Ai Weiwei, the artist, said, let's write some songs together. I'll write about my motherland, you write about your motherland. And so we did this. I said, that would be great. But he was in jail at the time, and I said, you know, why don't you come and you can Skype into this concert that I'm going to do in Toronto. And so he Skyped in and singing his motherland song, and I sang my motherland song. But you know, we had the same problems with Skype in the concert that you do at home.
Okay.
You know, so, you know, he's singing away, and suddenly he's like, and the sound is going on, and then it freezes in another expression. So it's a very strange relationship to time, you know. And but it was a way to kind of also talk about place and technology and nature for both of us, of ways to write about how we feel about that. So.
Yeah.
We're winging it here, which is really nice. I really like that we just kind of have a very sketchy idea about what we're talking about.
Yes. We just go wherever we need to go.
That's right. Yes. It's really nice.
When you're on the North Pole, all roads lead south.
Yes, they do.
So, you know, yes, we take drip. Some of the many roads south.
Yeah.
I'd like to dwell a little bit on this relationship between technology, nature, science, art. I will do a quote now.
Okay.
There is an Icelandic philosopher, Thorsteinn Gylfason, who said when he was asked the impossible question, what is culture? You know, luckily we do not get those questions here on this stage. He was asked, what is culture? And he came up with, I think, a very good answer to that. He said, culture is doing things with care. Mm-hmm. And it is maybe what we are as human beings. It's where we come from, this need to do things with care, to take even things that are going to be used for completely basic needs, like bashing a coconut open, you know, and making something of them.
Yeah.
And it's so beautiful that the first tools that man created, like that we've found, you know, the stone axes, they are not just like something to bash things open with. They have a very beautiful curve. They are made with care. And it's possible that this element in the human being, making things with care, has brought us to where we are today. We do things so carefully. We our abstract thought, you know, has moved into many different fields, of course. So the situation, I'm going to go into the dark now. The situation with the Arctic, with the globe, with the climate change that is going on with all its effects, is the result of the same poetic nature that we are maybe using in our work.
That's interesting, yeah. I thought, because, you know, something that's, I don't know if you see it as a continuum, something that's made with care and then something that is made artfully and something that's made with other kinds of thoughts and feelings. But good design, it seems, would take us to a better place than we are now. You know, I mean, you would think that good design would include thinking about the results of that. And although I was in a TV station today, and all the cameras were robots, you know, that's good design. And they were just gliding really, really well. And I thought, on the other hand, this good design has put, you know, 50 great cameramen out of work, you know. And I see from my own work in music that the number of people that I used to work with has been replaced by one entity. In other words, I would work with people who would design sounds and mix them and make these instruments and then do the processing on them and then make the record and then mix the record and then distribute the record, and there would be 50 groups that I would work with. Now I work with one, Apple, for everything, for mixing, for the instruments, for the distribution, for everything. So, and where do all these people go? So, you know, that's a haunting question, and it is a kind of consequence of good design. Apple designs things at this. I'm not trying to do, you know, an advertisement here. I have an Apple computer that I keep looking at, but it is beautiful design, and yet it is taking us places that are we don't know exactly what to do with the consequences of this.
And all of a sudden, you have all these people who were used to do things with care and artfully.
Yeah.
No matter what it was, the shoemaker, the mixing person in the studio, or whoever, you know, all of a sudden, they've got nothing to do with their hands, you know, and the coordination of their minds and hands. And that is a sad thing, of course.
Yeah.
But let's move into the dark.
Okay, and, I'm ready.
And talk about the Anthropocene, the new era we find ourselves in, and which the disappearing Arctic is, of course, the big one of the big is a big symbol of. Yeah. You know, why do you think it is so difficult for people to grasp what is going on, that climate change is really happening and it has been going on for a while? The different effects of it are all over the world, but somehow we are not seeing it.
I think it's not being described so clearly. I mean, I've heard it also described by Timothy
Morton
as a hyper object, that climate would be a hyper object, as the internet would be a hyper object. So this object, this idea of this force, or this I don't know what else to call it, would be somehow a hyper object. How do you understand that word that he uses?
Well,
because that's one way of picturing these things.
I think what he's describing with the word hyper object is an object, is a real thing, which is beyond our grasp, mm-hmm. and is really beyond our capability of thinking about it. Mm-hmm. But we have to acknowledge that it is there, that there is a hyper object mm-hmm. that is bigger than we can grasp, mm-hmm. and that climate change is not only a happening, that we have to think about it as a thing, and maybe he is proposing it so. Maybe he's proposing it in the hope that we will react to it, mm-hmm. because maybe we can't react to abstracts.
Right, you physically see a big space, alien spaceship coming towards us, something you can fight against, kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, Jimmy? Yeah. To just, objectify it, and there's the enemy coming at you. I don't know, I think it's also hard for people to feel entropy. It's very depressing to feel things that are winding down. You know, we like things winding up. We're builders. We like building things and going places. And the opposite is just troubling. It's something that's out of our control. We also like to have control and make good designs and all of this stuff. And so when something starts falling away from you, it's I think something that you almost can't see so well, and it's also a very fractured picture. A lot of thing people don't put that together. You know, today in the news, the weather report on CNN in the U.S. was the weather guy is talking about the hurricane in Houston, which turned into a major flood, and so someone is asking him, do you see any kind of pattern here with these superstorms that are hitting the U.S.? And he said, can't discuss statistics, which is code for, there is no climate change. And everyone heard that as that, because that is now a kind of, we're not allowed to keep track of statistics. It is becoming illegal to do that, because climate change doesn't exist as a situation in the U.S. officially. So our Department of Energy has been more or less put out of business. Yeah. And business is, of course, the operative word here, because it's a situation in which the government is not really able to tell corporations what to do. It's the opposite. The corporations tell the government what we're going to be doing, how we're going to, move this along, because privatization, this is such a cliche saying this, and I feel kind of silly saying it, but, I think one of the things that is very hard for us to face is that we're losing control of being able to actualize things, and that is tragic.
Yeah, we've lost control, and maybe we are simply still at the mercy of the idea that the earth and the ecosystem is simply so big that it is impossible for us, to alter it, to damage it, we can say. We've been dumping things in the sea forever. Mm-hmm. There's even a saying in Icelandic, "Lengi tekur sjórin við," the sea receives endlessly, just dump it in the sea, just dump it in the sea, it's so big. And of course now the sea, like all the rest of the ecosystem, is suffering. And this idea that we could actually make those amazing natural forces suffer, I think, is something that we are not attuned to that idea.
Yeah, it's a very painful idea.
Yes, it's a very painful idea. And you described beautifully how you felt when you saw the solar eclipse and the moon and the sun side by side. And I think, you know, it's we have a very strong need for experiencing things that are bigger than us, you know. I mean, we want to climb the mountain, but we want there to be something more, mm-hmm. you know. When we're on the top of the tallest mountain, we want to take off, you know. We need the challenge of something bigger. We need something that, you know.
There's the end of something that I wrote is a little bit about that. It just goes like something like, do you, you know, the reason I really love the stars is because we can't hurt them. We can't blow them up. We can't flood them or make them explode, you know, or make them, you know, disintegrate, you know. But we're reaching for them. You know, we're always reaching for them. So I think it's this push and pull of control and desire that makes it hard to see what's going on, I think. One of the things.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm. When you do, are those ideas in your mind when you're writing and working? I mean, how much do they affect you as a writer? You
know. Those ideas?
Yes.
Well, I must admit that it is only relatively recently that I started seriously to think about those things and to get information and to meet people. This summer I was an artist in residence at PIC, which is the Potsdam Institute for Climate Change Impact Research. And there I met scientists who are at the forefront of modeling and researching what is really going on with the planet. A few weeks before it hit the news that this big ice shell was breaking off from Antarctica.
And Larsen C?
Yes. Yeah. You know, I had a meeting with one of them and he was describing to me what was actually happening there. And there was this group of people trying to explain to this author, you know, what was going on. Because they are in desperate need for the information to get out there. And they invited me to stay there for 2 months to absorb the scientific information. But they are clever enough to understand that I will, of course, not go away and write like the big anti-climate change novel or an article or some kind of a, you know, I will not be their messenger, you know. But they just want people to know what is going on and to take it seriously. And of course it will have an impact on what I do. And that is one of the things that Timothy Morton is saying in his books. And that is that now that we've entered the Anthropocene, we are constantly, and that this will change the human being. This doesn't sound so nice, but this is what he says is happening. It means that whatever you do with the awareness that you are having an impact on your surroundings on Earth, you know. And even though, you know, you feel that you're doing nothing wrong when you start your car, you know, there are millions of people starting their cars at the same moment. So I think the awareness of climate change will really have an impact on how I write, because writing is of course always about the human being and its relationship with the rest of the world. Yeah. And if there is a new point of view there, if there's a new awareness, you know, it will impact my writing.
Yeah. Completely. I mean, because it's, and everyone's lives too, it's how we have related to nature. If then we're, well, we had to figure out how to pronounce Anthropocene.
Yes.
Because, so Anthropocene is really kind of a new concept of, and it really is so enormous. It's so enormous that we have now entered this era in which we are impacting nature more than the other way around. in many ways. Now, that may be flattering us a little, you know, to ourselves, because, you know, I think we are creatures of nature, and we're ruled by those things. We're made up of a whole bunch of viruses, you know, for one thing, that we can't, you know, quite. So when we think we're in control of nature, not really, you know.
No, and that is, not of course, exactly. A part of the new understanding. That is, yeah. That we are animals.
Yeah.
We are animals with certain abilities. Yeah. And it's possible to see the human beings, it's possible to see the advent of language and the human being acquiring abstract thought as the greatest natural disaster yeah. to have ever happened yeah. to the animals and the rest of the ecosystem.
Oh, to animals, oh.
I think we should get a photo now here.
Yeah.
Yes, mm-hmm. Let's get one photo up here.
A picture of this, yeah.
It's 3:00.
Oh, you know what? That's my computer, and it's.
Oh, really? Is it your computer? Ah, it's 3:00.
In New York, it's 3:00. It has to be. It's got
3:00 in the Arctic.
Thank you so much. I like to have the time announced. I forgot to turn that off.
So this is a photograph from the Denmark expedition that went on from 1906 to 1908. Mm-hmm. And it was very well documented because all of the members of the expedition got cameras. Yeah. So we have a beautiful collection of those pictures here at the Royal Library.
Yeah.
And I chose this one because it shows that man was not alone on his expedition, mm-hmm. that there was another animal that he took along with him. And that is the dog. And I think we should talk about our relationship
with animals.
With yeah. animals.
Yeah, because I think I know I've learned a huge amount from hanging out with dogs. And I did a film called Heart of a Dog that was about a dog that I had who. Got very sick and went blind, and she just stopped moving completely. She wouldn't go over to her food. We had to pick her up to go to her food bowl. We had to take her, put her outside and bring her on walks, and you know, and she was just. A lot of dogs do very well when they go blind. They don't see so well anyway. You know, they have very good sense of smell. Wonderful hearing, sense of proprioception, they know where they are. So their eyes, you know. So she depended for her sociability and you know, made a kind of eye contact with people. So I kind of panicked. I found a dog trainer, and the dog trainer said, well, I taught my dogs to play music. I said, why? why would that help? So anyway, she said, let's try it. So she taught my dog how to play piano, and she, for a couple of years, ran into the studio every day. We had keyboards on the floor, and she would turn the keyboard on and play, and for an hour a day, roughly. And it became a kind of, you know, people would come in the studio and go, oh, well, what's the noon concert going to be? And she would, like, proudly play this stuff. She's like, you know, B.B. King or something. It was, oh. She was like, it became a kind of social thing. And also sound fills a room the way it bounces around. It's very physical. And it's also, you know, I mean, and really, you know, music saved her life, and I think a lot of musicians would say the same thing, you know, that it became a way of being with others. And but I think dog packs are also have that feeling and of sociability, and And so I have spent a lot of time, really. I did a lot of concerts for dogs as well, going the other way around. And that came about in a strange way. It was like I was doing I was supposed to give a commencement speech to some art students, and I was supposed to tell them how easy it was going to be when they graduated to just wipe out their student loan. We have huge loans that take 20 years to wipe out. And how great it was going to be when they got that job in the art world, like just like that. It would be so easy. And so I was sitting there in the mortarboard feeling really guilty and what a fraud I am to say this stuff. Yo-Yo Ma, the cellist, was there. And we were both just kind of like, it was so very hot, very boring. And I was saying, you know, sometimes when I do a concert, I look out and I imagine that the whole audience is dogs. And he said, I have that same fantasy. And I said, really? Okay, so whoever gets to do the next thing, gets to do that, invites the other. So I got a chance to do this I don't really know why I'm telling you this story, but it doesn't matter at this point. Anyway, I was asked to direct a festival, an arts festival in Sydney, Australia. And I was, designing all of these, designers and dancers and musicians and writers and all these people who would come to this festival. And I said, and also I'm like gonna do a concert for dogs. And this promoter didn't say concert for dogs. No, he just writes down concert for dogs. I was like, okay. So we did this concert, and we thought a few hundred dogs would show up. Thousands of dogs. So thousands of dogs showed up. And it was at the Sydney Opera House, and so we had this... The plaza was supposed to be, marked off for little, medium, big dogs, and they quickly covered the whole stairs all the way up to the Sydney Opera House sales. And so it was a short concert. It was about 20 minutes, and it began with an invocation for whales. So, because whales, why do animals sing, to find each other, like whales in the ocean, or dogs to use their GPS. I'm over here, I'm three blocks over here, I'm half a mile here. They make a map of their world. And so we played this concert, and staying away from the very low sounds, because dogs get very, very, very nervous with it. The world is falling apart. And I have to say, there are lots of Australian dogs who just want to rock. It's a rock. My personal favorites were the droolers, and they were all in the front rows, and they were just like... they didn't know why they were there. I mean, who knows why you go to a concert anyway? I mean, your friends are going out. But they didn't know how to behave, so they were very polite as a default mode, So they just... And so at the end, I was like, okay, dogs, let's make some sound. So little dogs let it rip. So the little, and all the people would cut their dogs. They're like, okay, mediums, and okay, big ones, and for 5 minutes, these dogs barked and howled, and it was the most beautiful sound I have ever heard, because it was just because they were free to bark. And so, anyway, that for me was a moment where I felt some incredible rapport with them. I mean, I feel that anyway, and because as pack animals, I think we have that in common, so much in common with them, as well as their natural kind of soulfulness. I mean, nothing against cats, but they really just sit on top of the refrigerator, don't they?
So, Laurie, we're going to see a clip from your film.
Yes. This film was a film about, I would have to say, to be pretentious, the time, about time and how we understand time, how we move through it. And so in the middle of the film, there's a book, As many times there, if whether I'm doing some kind of piece of music or opera or whatever, in the middle, hidden sometimes, is a book. And in this case, it's the Tibetan Book of the Dead, and it explains, or kind of, this is a little bit of a riff on the 49 days in the Bardo. And this 49 days in the Bardo is the idea of the Tibetans, that Tibetan lamas yell into your ears as soon as you die, because they, according to them, hearing is the last sense to go, so they yell instructions when you die, and they yell, you're dead now, look for two lights, you'll see two lights, don't go to the close one, go to the near, far one, and they give you very clear instructions about what to do, because it's very confusing. So this is a little film about, a section of this film, about how the senses are closing down, and how the and what happens in this world of illusion. And it probably should have said before this point, but I don't actually think that we are here in this library. Probably too late in the conversation to say something like that. But we're going to look just a minute or so of this, because we're kind of running out of time. We are already. But we'll look at this, and this is a section of my dog Lolabel, who enters the Bardo, And so let's look at this little short clip about illusion, really. Let's recognize this.
The cities, the mountains, the rooms, the trees, the train. Optical illusions. Not there. Like dreams made of nothing. Things you loved as living things move with a different speed. They disappear. Echo. Repeat. Liberation. Earth into water. Water into fire. Fire into air. Air into consciousness. The many days of silence. And loneliness. You are not alone in leaving this world. At first you don't realize you're dead, but continue doing things you used to do. Looking for things you've lost. Your mind overwhelmed by memories and plans. What am I? What am I?
Okay, so we're gonna come out of the Bardo for a moment. Yeah, so that's from the Bardo section. Yeah. Oh.
So maybe we should move into the subject of endings and beginnings and time, like you're doing in the film. And one of the things that we are faced with is a completely new narrative. Mm-hmm. And I think searching for hope in that narrative. There are many sad thoughts that come up when you think about the Anthropocene and what can ultimately go wrong. One thought I was struck with this summer was that there is nobody going to miss us. Because this story ends with no listener. If everything goes as bad as it could be, could go.
Yeah. So, and karma ends.
And
karma ends. So that if you're, from a Buddhist point of view, then the all of that energy goes where? And when I was asking my teacher about that, I was saying, what happens when there's nobody to use that energy anymore? And he said, that's why the Buddha talked about other universes. I was like, oh. It's like, no, we're not limited to our planet, you'll be happy to hear. So anyway, but you have so many, like, you had this, like, this great Bull of the North was one of these things that you were, kind of a story, an animal story. How did that go?
The Bull of the North?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, you know, I think we are in the phase of stories about things disappearing. Yeah. The ice is disappearing. The geographical location will be there, but the ice is disappearing. And of course, we should remember that the Arctic is not just a place of dreams and metaphors. You know, it's the home to many people. And the people who are living around the Arctic Circle are, of course, experiencing the effects of the climate change intensely in their own lives, both in their everyday lives, their hunting grounds are disappearing, and the seasons are changing, and all that. But they have, there is also a great cultural impact. And I read recently about a group of people living in Siberia called the Saka people. And for as long as anyone remembers, the bull of winter or the bull of the north has come to their place in December. And it's a magnificent, huge bull, white bull with blue dots and gigantic horns and the frosty breath. And it comes there in December and it keeps the temperature low. It keeps everything frozen. It keeps everything at, I think, minus 60 to minus 65 degrees Celsius. And it just stands its ground until March. That is when its horns start melting and slowly it gives in to spring. And this, like, I think, myths, when they are alive, is about a reality. And all of a sudden, the bull has weakened. The bull isn't there anymore. And it's having a big impact on how these people deal with everything in their world. So we are losing things, and we are losing animals, imaginary and not. There was an article recently in The Guardian about the lions of Africa.
Right.
And there is a real possibility now that the earth will become, will lose its lions.
Lionless era going into it, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And what happens when we lose the lions? We lose a whole world. I mean, we lose the animals, we lose creatures from the ecosystem. But we also, as if we just think selfishly, we lose a whole world of reference. And it's a very sad thought to think that, you know, let's say my grandchildren will have to explain to their grandchildren that when their great-grandfather was alive, Earth was still the place where lions lived. And maybe it's things like this that will move people into realizing and accepting that this thing is happening. We have a massive refugee crisis all over the world, you know. It's always blamed on wars, but those wars start for a reason. They start because of drought and water shortages and lack of access to the basic resources of life. So the refugee crisis are not triggering this response that is needed. Mm-hmm. Maybe the loss of lions will, I don't know. It sounds strange, but maybe we need something like that. What will happen the year the stork does not come to Denmark? You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When it stops beginning. I mean, I find it as a writer, as an artist, very hard to write beginnings, but even harder to write endings. That's why I never have an intermission, because then you have to write two beginnings and two endings. You know, so it's very difficult to kind of... And because in doing that, you have to have a certain relationship to time. You know, what is this? How are you wrapping up this story that you're telling? And I so much of what I think is looks a little bit like certain kinds of religion. There are ways not just so much to find goodness or perfection or whatever, but to explain time, you know. Where do we come from and where do we go? And these are huge mysteries that we actually have to sit here right now and go, we don't know. We don't know where we're going. How can we tolerate this? You know, it was really, like you saying, sadness, I mean, and of course it's sad, but it's much, much more than sad. You know, it's a way to kind of think, well, we could imagine the beginning, the Big Bang, can you imagine, then the Earth shedding this and becoming part of a cyclical thing? In a way, yes, you know, in a way, yes. And to create things that give people some sense of possibility and freedom are things that really mean a different thing to me now than they used to, you know, because we're in this place that is technology, could it rush in and fix this? It's very late. It's very, very late. I'm not, you know, I'm a wirehead, and I'm not waiting for the last minute, the one that the thing that tips, the tipping point, that kind of people go, whoa, we're really messing this up, let's fix it now. And you know, and suddenly the fire trucks come in and everything's, you know, last minute, boom. You know, I'm not waiting for that. I'm not sure what I'm waiting for. I'm just trying to make, I wanted to show a couple of pictures of one thing that I was trying to make, because it was really interesting to show it here in Denmark. Let's have a look at this. It's a virtual reality place that I made, which was just to be all these stories that you could fly through. So you put the goggles on, and then you just fly through these huge spaces. And for some people, it's quite scary because you get caught in crevices, and then you fly towards certain areas, and they begin to tell you these kind of stories, and it's all 1 million stories hidden in this space. Now, what I noticed about doing this, and we installed this at the Louisiana Museum in the festival, literature festival, for a few days, and a lot of people tried it. And I noticed that you can get out the top of this edifice, and you can go, if you keep going straight up, I think there's one view of that, you go straight up out to this kind of very pale sun. And I noticed that I would say the Danes have a kind of Icarus complex, because they all like headed straight up for the sun. You know, it's like out of this whole thing, they were just shooting up towards this kind of unknown place. Out of all of these kind of cavernous places, there was this kind of feeling like I can fly up to this. Place of great freedom. I guess it didn't include the pale sun, but anyway, you'll have to imagine that. I think this one is just going to loop forever. We can go back to our picture of ice now. This was a kind of way to make a world of words and stories and try to focus on how our world really is made of stories. And I become much more conscious of that in the last couple of years in the U.S. because really it's a situation that's not a political crisis. It's an existential crisis because it's now nobody really knows what's real, you know. Its reality has become very, very, very fragile, and partly through our ways that we're communicating, but also language and how we express these things. So when we try to express climate, you know, or things that are big and complex like that, it gets really complicated. So for example, you know, we listened for 2 years, our elections went on forever, for all these candidates who are saying, you know, here's my idea of how the world is, here's how it used to be, here's how it's going to be. You vote for the person whose story you like the best. How does it relate to reality? It's not so clear. You know, then there's a winner, and the winner starts, the stories continue, but they get shorter. They get to be tweeting. They're 10 word stories. Then half of them are called fake stories. And then you are like, what is real? What is this? It's chaos. And then this creation of chaos keeps going on, which is, you know, every day there's a new emergency. You wake up one morning, it's thermonuclear war. The next morning, it's neo-Nazis. The next, we're building wall. It is. An absolute crisis of reality. You know, we don't really know. And so the way that we're communicating in this hive-like way, I mean, and you're in this too. You're like here in the news just as it happens too. You're like in this web of, like, you know, kind of fear and much of it misinformation. So having being able to be part of something that is looking at climate and sitting in a library looking at this is for me a really wonderful opportunity to just think, how can we use what we have to look at this at our world, you know, without being so swayed all the time by the politicization of it, you know, or the weather person who says, we don't have any statistics. I don't know why they're superstorms. But we're just cave people, you know. We just don't know anyway, you know. So being in the library with this huge repository of maps of Mercator, this unknown. I mean, I almost feel like we're back to that Mercator projection of, like, the big unknown at the top of the world, you know. We don't know what that is. It's got four rivers and something.
So what we can do as artists and writers and musicians is just keep doing what we do best, which is making beautiful things and hoping that the beautiful things expand our possibilities of thinking and maybe creating new language which allows for thinking new solutions. Is that what we do, apart from letting people know that we care, that this is something that we are worried about?
How do you defend yourself then again, you know, like, how do you not be overwhelmed by this? And still, what you're saying is great, it sounds great, but I get so overwhelmed by this sometimes, seeing something that's doing that. I mean, what is your defense? How do you do that?
I think we should just take 5 minutes in the morning and be completely overwhelmed and then go back to do what we're doing. Something like that. That would be one way, yeah?
You know, I have a teacher who is, he is, his name is Mingyur Rinpoche, and he is technically the happiest person in the world, according to the Wisconsin Neurological Department, because they do tests of to measure happiness, and they play very, very terrifying and grating sounds, and they measure your response. And it's not to measure the response of your cold-heartedness so much as your ability to have equanimity. And so one of the things that this teacher had says that I like very much is he said, you have to, it would be good to practice how to feel sad without being sad. And I like that distinction very much because it's a very real one. You know, there are many, many sad things in the world. And if you don't see them or feel them, you're an idiot. They will come and they will get you. I mean, everybody knows that. You just pretend they're not there, they're there. But his idea is do not become them. So do not become sad. It's also a little bit what F. Scott Fitzgerald or gave some advice to young writers. He said, you know, try to be able to, every young writer needs to be able to practice holding two opposing things, one in each hand. They're absolute opposites. And you are able to hold them both without going crazy. And when you can do that, then you can move ahead. So I think I'm always curious about how artists feel about this, or how people feel about it. How do you, knowing this, what do you do? So I guess try to acknowledge, like you say, acknowledge it, yeah.
Our time is up.
We have acknowledged
that climate change is happening.
Yeah.
We do care about the Arctic and the people living there. We will continue making beautiful things. We will allow ourselves to feel sad and angered about it, but we will continue creating.
It's been really fun talking with you. Thank you so much.
Well, the same here. Thank you.